Before we get to this, you do a lot of work as the US Senior Vice President at Save the Children, and we've just been hearing Michael Reagan, yes, obviously son of a president, talking in really graphic, harrowing terms about the abuse he suffered. What do you think of the whole Sandusky case?
Well, I know, you know, having, before I went to Save the Children, I started a program for juvenile delinquent kids in Baltimore City, and the first rule of any work with kids is if you suspect, have any inclination that there's abuse going on, you got to go right to the cops. It's like the cardinal rule, and if you have any sense of it, you've got to report it to the police immediately.
Let's turn to your father, who was a remarkable man.
Yes.
I didn't know how remarkable. It was, you know, it's not my royal family. We have a royal family, and you are the nearest thing to it in America, the Kennedy clan. I found it really a gripping read. He is, you know, in many ways, was a national hero in his own lifetime. Why did you write the book? What was the purpose?
You know, after he died, I essentially didn't know what to do. And a lot of friends told me that he was a good man. And I thought that was just something nice that people said. And I stepped back. My brother said, you ought to write your feelings down. And that's exactly what I did. I tried to figure out how he could be happily married for 56 years, raise 5 kids that all love him, and get an understanding of what made him so joyful. So I started writing. And that's exactly what this is. It's a son trying to understand how his father ticked, what made him so happy, what gave him so much energy, which made him so successful. And I understand, or came to the realization, that he was a good man. And it's different than being a great man. There are a lot of great people.
Yeah, I agree.
And when the lights turned off, they're not good to the people behind the cameras. They're not good to the people at the restaurant. But Dad was consistent on that.
I was struck by, if you look at his checklist of achievements, it's extraordinary. You know, Washington inside of a decade, candidate for president and vice president, founding director of the Peace Corps, served on a Navy submarine in World War II, U.S. ambassador to France, so on and so on and so on. But I was more struck by a letter, a handwritten letter that, yes, he sent you on graduation day, yes, which I'm going to read. It said, Mark, congratulations. Always remember, numero uno, that you are a unique, infinitely valuable person. Your mother and I love you. So do your brothers and sisters and friends. But all our love and interest put together cannot compare with the passionate interest that love that God himself showers upon you. You are his. He wants you. And he will make you the perfect man you want to be. Love, Daddy. And the reason that it was so powerful is your father was a very, very staunch Catholic. He went to daily mass, I think.
Absolutely.
Right till he died.
Yes.
Clearly believed that his love of God was the underpinning of his entire life.
That's exactly right. And it was a belief, though, an inclusive God. It was not a God that put people in boxes or in corners. It was a God that reached out to Jews and Protestants and Muslims and Catholics to do our Father's business. That's what he called it. He was interested in trying to eradicate poverty in this country and abroad and helping my mother spread Special Olympics all around the world. And I stepped back and I had to figure out what made the guy tick. And he wrote me those letters almost every day of my life. And
did he really?
Yeah, he did. He'd slip them under the door. When I was in college, he'd mail them. When I got married, he'd, you know, mailed a couple every day.
Really?
Books. Oh, yeah. Books.
Wow.
He was a voracious reader. And trying to read those letters and go back and understand what they said, read some of his speeches, and understand how he dealt with problems like, you know, when I had problems as a kid growing up. And so many families deal with issues like our family did. We're no different, really. We get a little more publicity, maybe. But we deal with issues day in and day out.
I mean, oddly, your father seems to have escaped a lot of the fable Kennedy curse in the sense that you look at his life, and actually it was a very happy, successful, and fulfilling life. I think
95 years, yes.
He put a lot of it down to, I think, the love of a great woman.
Yes.
He felt he was very lucky to have found your mother.
He always said that he called us the lucky seven, the 5 kids, my mom and him were the lucky seven. And he really, we were blessed. There was no question about it. But to figure out how a guy did that and maintained a happy marriage for 56 years, raised all those kids and did all the international work you talked about, is, I think, one of the joys and one of the mysteries I tried to figure out in this book. And there's so much you can learn from your parents even after they're dead. You know, I learn every day from my dad. I read the letters that he wrote that I put in a file, and I look at them and I read them, and they mean something different to me at 48 than they did when I was 18. They mean the power of unconditional love that he gave us all. So I'm hoping that the messages in the book resonate with people that are struggling to balance family and friends and faith and a commitment to their work.
What would he have made of the extreme partisan nature of modern politics, the fact that Washington is a complete basket case, they all hate each other, they can't get anything done, they don't work together. What would he have made of that?
I think, you know, political debates, campaigns are tough, and they ought to have good, hard discussions about where the country's going to go. And the history of America shows that, from George Washington right on through till today. I think what the difference is that everybody who were leaders in the past, I think really did care about the country and making compromises in order to move the country forward. Mm-hmm. It wasn't only about how I'm doing today as compared to 4 years ago. And I think that's what made him